What's up, everybody? It is Ulysses Owens Jr. here with From the Drummer's Perspective. And I'm so excited I get to talk to my brother today. Before we get cats on the line, I want to see who's out there. Please chime in. Let us know where you are. Tell us where you're from. Maybe a few of you all have been checking out and chiming in with us every week. Maybe send us a note. But it'd be great to know who's out there in the world. Where are you? Last week we had some folks from all over the place, so it'd be great to see where you are. Really, really excited to talk to Kendrick today. He is very, very different, and I'm such a fan. For those that are checking out the music, I'm always honored when people tell me how much they love my new big band album. Soul Conversation. So this is a track from there. It's London Town. So here we go. Peter Violin from Stockholm. Yes, I like Stockholm. Reggie, yeah, from Bed-Stuy. Love it. Roland from Switzerland. Sergio from Romania. Nice. I love Stockholm, Peter, man. It's a great town. Bed-Stuy will be there in a few weeks. Actually, I'll be in Switzerland soon. I just got confirmed yesterday. I'll be playing in Bern, Switzerland. So thank you all for tuning in. And continue to please drop a note and let us know where you're from. Andres, thank you. Oh, man, from Colombia. Cool. So thank you so much for tuning in. But I just want to say how excited I am to talk to Kendrick. He is somebody who I've really been admiring for many years. You know, there's obviously drummers who are way above me in terms of age, you know, and some of the drummers on this podcast, you know, were quite a bit older from different generations. But what I love about Kendrick is that he and I are actually from kind of the same generation. And I think he got to New York about a year earlier than me. And I never forget meeting him, which I'll share that story when he hops on. But I just want to say, I think that he has evolved into such a great musician and artist. And I think one of the things that I've learned from him through the years is he's really great at, like, creating concepts of putting the drums in the front. And like, as a band leader, like, you clearly understand that it's his vision, but he's not having to forecast, like, this is my band. And so he's really taught me that element of being musical while also being a band leader. And then just as a drummer, he's got obviously great hands. If those that follow me on Instagram, you see the clip I posted earlier today. I mean, he's just so fluid on the kit, has the tradition of all the greats, and comes from an incredible town of so many wonderful drummers as well. And again, every time I see him, there's a very short list for me of drummers that every time, first of all, if I hear they're playing, I try to go see them and hear them. Two, when I see and hear them, I walk away and I think something differently in a positive way about the kit and about my own playing. And I think it's because he approaches the music from a very spiritual place, but also just he does all the right things at the right time. And he's one of the most in-demand drummers, musicians on the planet, and one of my favorite people to rap with, and also incredibly humble and very supportive. So everyone, please welcome the amazing and brilliant Kendrick Scott.
Yo. What's up?
Man, so
thank you for the kind words, man. Appreciate it.
Oh, man, it's all truth, man. That's one of the things about the show that for me is really important is obviously there are people on the show that I may not know as well, but I really want to have people on here that all of us are inspired by. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, man, I want to dig right in because, you know, you share a commonality with several drummers that I've had on, one of which being Eric Harlan.
Yeah.
You're from Houston, man. So, like, what was happening in Houston? Like, because all y'all, like you, Jermire, Chris Daddy Dave, like, you know, Mark Simmons, like the list goes on and on. So anyway, man, how did you grow up? What was the vibe like in Houston? And you know, how did you get connected to the instrument?
Well, yeah, I'm in Houston now, actually.
Oh, yeah.
It's great. It's great to be down here. But I guess through my mother is a pianist, a gospel pianist, and my brother plays organ. And my mother was like going up to GMWA and playing with James Cleveland and doing stuff like that. So I come from that type of background, gospel, Baptist background. And so my first kind of moments were just seeing the drums in church. running up to this guy, Eric Porter, after church.
Wow.
And just like, just begging him to just bang on the drums after church. It was, wow. And the thing about Houston, there's always an actual line of drummers just waiting to go after church. Like, show me what to do. You know what I mean? It's like one of those things. And so they finally let me get up there. And then my parents got me some, they got me a pad and, you know, started beating on a pad. 2 years later, they were just like, all right, we should get him a drum set. I still remember to this day, my dad's like, all right, this drum set is $1,000. Like, are you really gonna deal? You know, and to this day, he always brings it up. He's like, you a Yamaha now, right? He's like, yeah, you know, they give me drum. He's like, really? Like, remember that time that I told you that you better play these drums if you get them? Because I think he bought my brother like a saxophone. He never played it, you know. But it was a blessing to just kind of come to the drums in that way, coming from a sense of music was made for a message, and there was a message meant for each of the things that we're doing inside the church. So church was like the beginnings of it, and I still carry that, you know. And so then I got into middle school, and I was playing some drum set, but it was mainly just trying to get into marching band. Then I just fell in love with marching band. You know, in Texas, football is huge. So you go to the football games, it's all about the football and the marching bands and all of that. So DCI was like a real thing in my mind. I was like, man, I want to do DCI. And so I worked on my rudimental chops for so long, just trying to do that. Mm-hmm. And then twirl sticks and be on the field and be a hype man. And then by the time it was time to go to high school, mom was like, okay, I know you want to go to this other school named Willeridge and march in a band. But she was like, what professional marching bands do you see? What professional marching bands do you want to join? And I was just like, the cadet. I was like, oh, you be in there for a couple of years, right? It's like, oh, yeah, okay, I guess I should think beyond that. So she was like, you should, you know, you should audition for the high school for performing and visual arts.
Right.
And that was been the best thing that has happened in my life. You know, one of the best things, you know. So when I got there, Walter Smith was there, and Glasper and Beyonce and Mike Moreno and Harlan had just left. Moran had come from there. I don't know. Chris Dave went there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, even going back to when I was a little kid, I remember seeing Chris Dave at some of the gospel music things around town and just being like, OK, that's what I want to do. I remember he had the 13-inch Dennis Chamber snare. Remember that snare, the soprano snare?
Yeah.
I was just always like, oh man, I knew it was right for me because I remember that snare. I remember, I think I saw another interview. I think you were, Billy was drumming, was talking about just sitting there and looking at the drums. You know what I mean? Just like, you know what I mean? That's when you know you got the bug. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I was listening to his playing, but I was also just like, ooh, I want to, So anyway, you know, I went to the Performing Arts High School. Mm-hmm. Then was blessed to go to Berkeley, and the family continued throughout that. You know, it's like me and Walter Smith and Mark Kelly, who's now with the Roots. We all went up to Boston together. And then after that, I came down to New York. So, I mean, it's been a journey, you know, from the beginnings. It's crazy, you know, whenever I'm like doing teaching, mentoring and stuff, I'm always like, man, you realize it's just a family, right? It's just, it's the more I'm realizing, man, the older I get, and I've been told this, but now I see it. Music isn't about music. It's about life. You know what I mean? And the more we connect with people, and during the pandemic, we've seen, we miss that connection.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Yeah. And for me, it's been hard to do music without the connection of the people, you know?
Right.
That's something I've been yearning for. So I'm happy to be here with you, brother. And, you know, one of the great things is, you know, a wall does become a bridge, because then the pandemic leads us to reach out in other ways
and find
other ways to reach out. So it's great. It's great.
I like that album plug, bro.
That's been my saying.
Man, so I want to go back a little bit. First of all, you know, because I grew up, you know, in the South and church and all that, and my mother loves James Cleveland. So the fact that your mom played with him and also at GMWA, because I have a lot of friends that are Kojic, that's a pretty big deal. So, you know, more specifically in terms of drums, what did you learn, or like, you know, I'm sure you had a formal instructor, or did you have a formal instructor? Like, so, you know, like from church to like, obviously the shout and groove or whatever, there are things that we all, cause that was kind of an era of gospel music that, as you know, wasn't really about all the loops or anything that it is now. It was really only a few grooves. It was really
straight traditional.
Right. You know, it was just like a slow groove, a shouting groove, you know, it was like,
That 12-8.
Really, you're right. Right. Yeah. You know, so, anyway, so like what kind of technically on the drum side did you get foundationally from the church, and you know, you talk about drum corps and stuff and marching, which I went through that as well, but because you have really, to me, you have really great technique. So what was that foundation? Yeah.
Well, I guess the foundation from church was be in service to the music.
Right.
And that meant playing less, you know what I mean? Mm. But, and that's probably why I look more to marching band and stuff, because I saw cats just ripping on the drums, you know what I mean, on a single drum. I was just like, oh, I want to do that. But I think, you know, just getting to just think about the drums being of service, that was just the main thing. My mom would always just, you know, you play a little something they don't need, my mom would be like you know, just that look, or just, you know, good.
See, so your mom was a pianist. My mom was a choir director.
Oh, okay. So
I'm laughing because, bro, I used to get them looks all the time.
Yeah. And you ever see, what's that? It's like a video going around where the dude, he's trying to stop the drummer, and they're just trying to do the praise without the drums.
Oh,
the
I got to watch it.
It's killer, because I've been there before. You just be so excited. It's like, oh, yeah. Wow. But I mean, that's just the main thing. Just trying to play simple, which I'm trying to do now, you know, just trying to take those lessons, and those lessons actually continue and still continue now, you know. Mm-hmm.
So did you get like the person that said, all right, you know, Kendrick, you're going to learn, you know, these 28 essential rudiments, or like, or did you not really get more of that? Okay.
I had one teacher named Roderick, who was my first teacher.
Okay.
And he just taught me to play pretty much my church grooves. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then by the time I started getting into middle school, Sam Dinkins taught me a few lessons. Hmm. Sam Dinkins is a great teacher. And Daryl Singleton was my main teacher down here. And he was at Texas Southern University.
Okay.
So he's the one that got me on all my rudiments and some Will Coxon and all that type of stuff. So the thing about the lineage is that most of, I didn't really come in the path that a lot of the other cats took, which was to go to Johnston Middle School, where Craig Green was.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
Yeah, Craig Green was the cat that taught most of the cats. Mm-hmm. And so I had only had a couple of times being around Mr. Green, and he's such a great dude. But so I went to another middle school and then got into the high school that everybody, so I conversed at the high school with everybody, but I didn't get that same middle school. But, you know, I had some lessons with Sebastian Whitaker, who was an excellent drummer down here who we all idolized. Mm-hmm. And he was like the big brother that was teaching us all about Blakey and all about the Blue Note Records and everything. So those were my main influences from, you know, looking outward, and then on the inside were my big brothers. I think that's one of the things about being in Houston is each one teach one, right? So, I mean, Reggie Quinterly is right with me, and then Jamire was younger than us, and then Clyde Adams was after us, and then it was Harland, and then, Mark Simmons, and then Chris Dave, and then, you know, it's just the line is just, and then Jeremy Dutton is younger than Jamire, so you know what I mean, it's like, and then Jerome Gillespie and like all these younger cats, it's just the whole line is the each one teach one thing, and you know, that's important in passing down just the love and the hunger just to want to make it happen.
Man, I wondered also, I see one of the audience members, Ryan Milliken, I think, he wrote the statement, Charlie Wilcoxon strikes again. And I wanted to ask you, you know, I think I asked either Terry or Billy, one of them, but what do you think about the relevance of the instructional drum book, right? Because I feel like, you and I and our generation, we've all gone through that because most of us all have gone to college. But I feel like we were also fortunate that we formed and still are forming our own style. But by the time you and I both got to New York, like Blakey wasn't there anymore. Billy Higgins wasn't there, you know. And from what I heard, Wilcoxon was sort of somebody sort of transcribing a lot of that language from, you know, the forefathers or whatever. So, you know, what do you think about that? Like, do you think the drummer today needs, especially if they want to, you know, follow in our footsteps, do they need to check out a Wilcoxon? Do they need to check out syncopation? Like, what are your thoughts around that?
Well, I mean, I have a four-pronged approach to what I think about learning. And the first thing is technical practice. The second thing is conceptual practice. Then you have imaginative practice and spiritual practice. So for me, technical practice involves approaching the instrument and knowing that it doesn't care about you. You know what I mean? It's like you sit down and you try to play something and you suck. So you could sit down and be like, dang, I suck. Okay, so what do I practice? Or you just open up the book and be like, oh, okay, this is something that this is kind of cool. This is what the cats played. Oh, let me try to do that. And then I always think like either you do really good or you really suck at it. And it tells you, it really gives you the feedback that you need. You don't need feedback that's in between. You need the feedback that's like, oh, I'm killing at this, or I suck. And then you really practice it. So for me, instructional books are just kind of how I learned after first listening and doing, the conceptual practice is just using your ears. And I don't think cats do that enough to where you're just like, you know, can you sing it? Can you, not only can you sing it, can you embody it? And so, you know, I have this approach to doing like anything. If you're reading any book, I have my students like answer these questions. The first question is, can I execute every sound in silence? So you open up syncopation, da, 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 da. Okay. Then can you do it in time? Da, 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 da. Then can you make a groove? Da, ga, then can you create a feeling from it? Can you make me angry? Can you make me sad? Can you make me feel light like a butterfly? And then can you make it effortless? You know, so those five questions are what I go by anything that I'm practicing. So I think when you're really stuck, you know, and you're just like, you've listened to a record, or maybe you hadn't listened to a record, you're just like, dang, I want to practice something. I think if you open up any book and approach it with those five questions, it's going to lead you to a deeper level of just playing the book. You know what I mean? So, but I mean, you know, the music is first. I mean, the music will give you everything you need if you're listening to the music like that. And I will admit that I do listen to the music like that, but sometimes I don't know where it's like, okay, a 17/8 groove. It's like, okay, maybe I'll listen to some Billy Cobham, but maybe let me look in this book. It might have some things that might open me up to thinking about different ways of subdividing 17/8. You know, man, stuff like that.
So I got to go back, man. You're dropping some heavy, heavy, heavy gems, man. So the practice, you had the four points of practice, or what did you call those?
The four, I call them just it's like, I don't know. It's like my four principles of practice.
So you said technical practice, imaginative, conceptual. And what was the other one?
So it's technical, conceptual practice, imaginative practice, and spiritual practice.
Okay, spiritual. Yeah. I think that's so key, man, because like I haven't necessarily, I mean, this is really challenging because I haven't really broke down my philosophy of teaching in a pedagogical way in that way, because I've had to do it as an ensemble director at Juilliard, but it's been really cool because I know you do this at MSM. So it's really cool to see, like, you kind of break it down in that way. Like, that's how I teach, but to hear, like, to see the clarity of that. And I think it's really great, because I also think it's very truthful, or I should say truthful to the music and how you did that. Like, we need the technical proficiency, obviously. You need the imagination, the concept, the conceptual, but it also boils down to the spirituality of it. And, you know, I feel like you don't get to spirituality in your playing, not really directly, until you kind of get to college and, like, gigs. But it's really cool to see you kind of almost like Tenants, like you sort of like Tenants.
That's the word, Tenants. Yeah. And the way I think about it, man, is I think about it as a pyramid. At the bottom is the technical. At the bottom is the technical.
Wow.
Then you get the conceptual. Then you get the, you know, imaginative. And the spiritual is this little corner at the top in which everybody wants to live, right? Everybody wants to, you know, be as inventive as Roy Haynes, but they're not realizing all this other stuff that's happening is, like, leading to this godly stuff. The godly stuff is actually very small compared to just how great they are at doing simple things, you know. So I always say simplicity breeds complexity. You know what I mean? It's like, if you do all these simple things, just think about, you know, what we all think about, just listening to Tony Williams' ride cymbal, and you really think about it, it's pretty simple. Just him doing that. Right. You know, that was the first record that made my hairs stick up on my body was, Funny Valentine.
Yeah.
You remember that dude? He was in the background. He said, when they started swinging.
Yeah.
Man, my hairs rose up. I was about 13.
Wow.
And I said, if I can play the cymbal like that just to bring in the time and make it feel like that. And I've been searching for that feeling every time I sit down. I search for that feeling because that's the same feeling that I got when I heard a lady sing in church.
Yeah,
and it was praising, and you know, you get to that point like, I'm not gonna cry, man.
Yeah.
like everybody's shouting, you'd be like, no, man, I'm cool. I'm all right, you know.
Tear, the glory tear.
yeah. So that was the same feeling, and I was just like, this is connected. That's when I knew I just connected to music in a certain type of way, and I never doubted, you know, doing music. Yeah.
So was Tony's ride cymbal beat? Was that the first, like, beat, like, that you heard, like, that sort of jolted you or sort of, introduced you to the sound of a beat? You know, because, like, in church, obviously, everything is, you know, boom, chuck, boom, chuck, whatever.
Yeah.
At least church of that era. So was that the first jazz cymbal?
I mean, there were other sounds. I mean, Grady Tate was in there. Woo! It was like, I was listening to Grady Tate with, like, Lionel Hampton.
Okay.
And some Max Roach, you know, cats, you know, but Tony's, it just hit me a certain way, you know, when you're at an impressionable age, you know, and I tell people all the time, don't be embarrassed of what introduced you to the music. Cause me and Walter Smith talk all the time about, like, what kind of brought us, and he loves Kenny G. And he's not, people think he's joking, but he actually loves Kenny G, because Kenny G was one of the people that brought him to the saxophone to make him want to play. And so it's kind of like one of those things. It's like, well, yeah, but I like this cat. It's like, no, that's cool. But are you listening to the other cats? That, you know what I mean? Do you know what else is happening?
I'm so glad you brought that up, because like for me, I got introduced to jazz drumming through Buddy Rich. And I feel like when I was living in Florida, a lot of cats loved it, you know, like, oh, Buddy Rich. When I moved to New York, it was like, yeah, Buddy, okay, but you checked out Papa Joe, or you check, you know, it's, and even in some ways, you know, it becomes a racial thing, right? Like, there's certain cats, it's like, oh, well, if you really trying to check out the cats, like, you got to make sure you check out these guys. And then it kind of becomes like them versus us, you know. But I love that you said that about Walter, because it's interesting you say Kenny G, because Walter has that lyrical sense to his playing. So, like, you know what I mean? And in other words, like obviously he doesn't sound like Kenny G, but there is a sense of, like, as technical as he is, there is this simplicity and this, like, lyricism in his playing that is very melodic to me. That's very different than, like, the jazz tenor saxophonist.
Right, you know?
So you know, I think that's really beautiful, sort of your encouragement of, like, don't be ashamed of, like, what got you.
Oh, whatever, you know? Whatever leads you to the music is actually cool. It's, to me, it's, it, the question is, are you trying to take the ladder or are you trying to get the shovel out? A lot of people trying to take the ladder, get, you know, I want to get better, and they stay on that Kenny G thing. But then it's just like, wait, oh, what about Hank Crawford and, like, what about, okay, let me get the shovel out.
Yeah.
See what, how, where that came from and where the sound. And then you're going to find some other stuff where it's just like, oh, okay. You know, one of the greatest questions that Terrence Blanchard, and it's funny, I think of Terrence like an oracle, but one of the greatest questions he said, he's like, the question of who you are versus who you want to be. You know what I mean? That's just one great question. And, you know, as long as you're trying to be authentic to yourself while bettering yourself, then that's cool. It don't matter where you started. It's about where you're going, and it's about the process.
Right. So with that said, man, I have to say, I mean, I don't even know if you remember this, but when I met you, it was actually through Reggie Quinterly. And we actually, man, so we met at, there's a great trombonist friend of mine, Barry Cooper. We actually met at Barry's place in Harlem. This is like years ago. And you won't even remember this, but we met, and I remember freaking out because Reggie, like, I already knew Reggie was a drummer. We had already been cool and hanging because he's very close with one of my cousins. And I remember you came to the apartment with him. He's like, oh, yeah, this is my homeboy Kendrick from Houston. And I'm like, hold on, Kendrick Scott? And, man, I'm like, but I'm trying to, like, play it cool, you know, and because I was already a fan. And then I remembered this club, Kavahaz. Do you remember that spot?
Yeah.
Mercer Street. Yeah. And I remember being like, hold on, that's the Kendrick I met at the party. And, you know, it really blew my mind. But I say all that to say that I think where I really started to understand how killing you were, bro, was when I first heard you with Terrence's band. And can you maybe talk to me about that process of, you know, you went to Berkeley, you leave Berkeley, like, how do you get into Terrence's band? Because I feel like, obviously, Eric, to me, really created a new sound in that band, and I can't even imagine what it was like to come in after him. And I remember being like, well, man, who's going to follow Eric Harlan? And when you came in, I feel like not only did you fill those shoes, but then I feel like you elevated to where Terrence, because I feel like Terrence's music changed. Like, Eric sort of came in and was like, all right, we're gonna like open this shoe up. You came in and was like, okay, you know what? We're gonna put on some new shoes. And I really love that transition of Terrence's band. So anyway, what was that process of meeting him? And then obviously all the film stuff y'all did, man. So yeah, just any of that you wanna share with us.
Well, you know, like I was saying, it is about music, but it's not, you know, because like I was saying, Eric was my big brother. So when I was coming into high school, Eric was graduating high school.
Yeah.
And, you know, like there were certain moments, that moment that I told you about where I heard Tony and the hairs raised up. There was a moment when Eric came back down here and he played at the Wortham Theater and he played with Betty Carter. And first of all, I'd never seen a singer sing like Betty. And I never seen a singer encourage the band in which she was encouraging the band. You know how you see Kenny Garrett walk over to the drums and be like this, like standing in front of the drums?
Yeah.
She was doing that to Eric. And she pulled stuff out of Eric where it was just like, wow, what is happening? And she, first of all, she hears drums. Like, she heard everything that he was doing. And I was just, I thought that was the greatest thing I ever seen. I was like, okay, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life, for age 14. And so, you know, Eric has been constantly that big brother for me. You know, it's one of those things, we just hung out and he's like, man, you know, you're my little brother, right? Whether like we haven't hung out in months or whether we, you know, see each other every day, we just stand next to each other and it's like a vibration. It's like, man. And he's like, sometimes literally he'll turn to me and just be like, yeah, I know. I'll just be like, without even saying anything. And we have a weird connection. So that's that. Not a weird connection, a beautiful connection. That's my big brother. Wow. So when he was leaving Terrence's band, I believe he was going to play with Lloyd.
Okay.
Or so, you know, he was, Eric been doing so much stuff.
Right.
He was just like, look, you know, I was at Berkeley. And he was just like, you should think about Kendrick because Terrence had heard me. I did Jazz Ahead. Mm-hmm. And Terrence had heard some of my tunes and heard me play. And he was like, okay, cool. And, you know, he told Terrence to get me. And then, but I was still in school. I wasn't ready to leave school. Mm-hmm. So I actually said no at first.
You got to be kidding me.
I actually said no. Wow. And then, you know, a few months later, it's like, are you sure? You sure about this? And I was like, no, I'm not really sure. But no, I think I'm going to stay at school. It was like one of the craziest times for me. Because then Joe Sample and the Crusaders called me. I mean, that story, I'll make it very short. But Joe Sample is from Houston, Texas.
Oh, wow.
And he was living in L.A. for many, many years. All of them moved out to L.A. And then he was moving back home. And so me, Mark Kelly, and Walter Smith played at his homecoming party. And we were just off in the corner playing. And it's a party going on. You know how you do those gigs. And you're just like, yeah, whatever. And then all of a sudden, he's looking over like, oh, okay. And then he's like, oh, I'm going to play with the kids. And so we're like, okay. He comes and plays with us, whatever. I don't even remember what we played. But then 5 years later, he asked Walter Smith's dad, Walter Jr. He's like, who was that drummer at that party that I had for coming back home 5 years later? And then that's when they called me to audition to play with the Crusaders.
Wow.
So I had the Crusaders gig and Terrence's gig. And so I left school. So I stayed with the Crusaders for 3 years and I stayed with Terrence for 11 years.
Wow.
And so, you know, being with Terrence is, you know, that's some of the height of my career, because, you know, he coming from Blakey's legacy, mm-hmm. he was telling us, it's not about you being a killing musician in my band. It's about me training you up to be your own band leader. Right. And one of the things that I always talk about when I, you know, at least try to impart the little knowledge that I have, is that once we realize that we're all leaders, it's just about how much to lead and how much to follow, how much give and take of it you have. But we're all leaders, especially when you're on the bandstand. It's just like, okay, sometimes I can actually lead by creating space instead of taking up space. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That's a leadership thing to say, okay, y'all come out. Okay, pop. You know what I mean? The silence is leadership as well as sound. So, you know, Terrence taught me just a lot about, you know, how great things can happen when you just create space and get out the way. You know what I mean? And so when the space needs to be filled, though, he is that dude. He knows how to, you know, he can write out anything for you to play and anything that would be killing. But getting in the band was an interesting thing. It was a hard moment for me. Like I said, I was playing with the Crusaders. So in the Crusaders, it was more like playing in church. It was just like, all right, play that part. This is the groove. Play that. No more of the extra stuff. No more of the just, nope, play that. So then when I got in Terrence's band, he was like, yo, do whatever you want. And so when I got in Terrence's band, the crazy thing was my big brother had just been in the band. Eric Harlan was in the band. I learned everything Eric played and I played everything Eric played. I don't know how, but I tried to. But it was terrible. I remember we were in Japan and it was sounding terrible, but I was playing all that stuff. And I was like, oh, okay, so what records should I listen to check out, like, for what you want? He's like, there are no records to listen to. You got to listen to yourself and listen to the music and play the service of the music. That's why you're sucking, because you're thinking about, you know, all of these reference points. And then, man, that took me on a whole nother journey. That, and then when he told me, you know, he told us about his composition process, about how to take, you know, short musical seeds and create from them. And then the whole band started thinking that way. And I think that's why that band was special. You know, me, when Derek Hodge came in, it was just like, we started thinking in a certain compositional way as bass and drums. Yeah. And, you know, I still carry all of that with me today.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I find that you and Derek and Lionel, right? Like all of y'all like left and you're obviously you're doing great things, but everybody is like really moving as a compositionally. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like you're doing your thing as a band leader. Yeah, you know, still play with other cats, but, like, you know, as I trace, like, I'm looking at your Spotify page, you know, and I look at the first record of yours. I checked out The Source, and then, like, Conviction, and then I listen to, like, Where You Are Now with, like, A Wall Becomes a Bridge. And yeah. It's just really, you could hear the growth, and same thing with Lionel, same thing with Derek, you know, with the things he's doing. So it's really, that's really unique to hear about Terrence and how he explained your process. Another question I want to ask you about that period. I was listening to this really great writer today, Simon Sinek, and he talked about how a lot of people, he wrote a lot of great books like Start With Why and one I'm reading now, The Infinite Game. But he talked about how a lot of times we always want to talk about our successes. And he said you'll learn more from people obviously talking about their mistakes. And and he actually says if there is a shortcut in sort of entrepreneurial success, it's actually learning from people's mistakes. So I said, man, I need to shift kind of like my questioning with my interviews because I feel like I talk a lot about people's successes. But I wanted to ask you, you know, you talked about the Japan mistake, like, or not mistake, but sort of you shifting. What are definitely some key mistakes that you may have made, whether it's with Terrence or in that period of your career? Because I feel like after Terrence, I feel like you like ascended, you know. So
yeah,
anything else you want to share along the same lines? You know?
I think the key mistakes are being too insular, not concentrating on everybody else.
Wow.
You know what I mean? I think key mistakes are things that you already know inside of you, but you kind of go outside. Like I told you in the beginning, I knew that music was supposed to be of service. My mom taught me.
Right,
she gave me the side eye.
Right.
She gave me the side eye, and I still see the side eye when I know I'm not supposed to be doing what I'm doing. So usually that type of musical mistake is just like, oh, I actually know that. So it's actually something that you fight with sometimes. Some of the mistakes, and it's, sometimes it's not about your naivete about something. It's more about you saying like, oh, okay, I know this, but I want this, you know. Let me think. I mean, other things are a lot is about awareness. And are you aware of what the band needs? Are you aware of what personally what people need? How do you deal with people inside of the band, inside of how we're traveling, and inside of like how we're moving together? Are you uplifting or are you taking away? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that has a lot to do with how the music sounds. You know, but man, look, I make plenty of mistakes. I'm still making mistakes.
No, just
at all times. But that's a good question. I have to sit down, you know, and really, really meditate more on it, you know, because, you know, at the same time, you know, the greatest thing, well, actually, wow, that brings me to, it makes me think about Herbie. So when I did this tour with Herbie, it was 44 straight gigs.
Wow.
And actually, wow. I made a big mistake at the beginning of the tour, first gig, like first tune. I think, of course, it's the first gig. First.
What
tune.
A way to start off.
Yeah. You know, I made a mistake. And it was kind of like, it wasn't a big mistake, but it was a mistake. And guess what? I couldn't let it go. You know, and Herbie did like two-hour shows, right? So in the two-hour show, I walked up to Herbie, be like, you know, I'm sorry about that, man, on the first tune. He was like, the first tune. He's like, that wasn't a mistake. That was an opportunity.
Woo!
And so that means, you know what I mean? And so here it is. That was an opportunity. And 2 hours later, that opportunity is still sitting there, and you didn't take it. So
whoa.
I was just like, so the greatest the greatest thing that it happened the first tune of the first set, because then the learning experience came from there the whole tour. Then it was like, oh, okay. And then the second thing that happened was I think the next day when I was open and finally like, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. I found out that Herbie Hancock was listening to me. it sounds like whatever, but I'll play something and he would kind of respond. And I was like, wait, is he listening to me? I thought I was just playing behind, you know, just to support the master, right? He was like listening to what I did. I remember he played this one chord that sounded like glass. And I still to this day do not know how he did that. Like, he has certain things that just sound like, and it sounded like glass, but it was like after something I played. And, you know, that just reminded me the greatest thing you could do is not to give somebody something, but to listen to them. You know what I mean? And that's what he did for me. And I was like, okay, if this dude who is the dude of all dudes could be humble enough to listen to me and to play with me, that was, you know, that taking mistakes as opportunities, you know, he learned that from Miles, and just the listening aspect, the combining those things, that just took me on a whole nother stratosphere.
Man, first of all, I'm glad I asked that question, because that was some of the heaviest stuff. So continuing along those lines of playing with Herbie, another band that some of my favorite records, like, you know, they have the whole saying of like, what are the records you would take to the island, you know, if you couldn't bring any more music. And I have to say, man, Gretchen's Records, bro, that you're on, like it's so musical to me. So, you know, you go from Herbie, you play with Gretchen. I see you're about to do the SF Jazz Collective. How do you change gears? Because I actually wanted to ask you that earlier. Like, how did you change gears from like church? And then also, how do you change gears from, you know, you talk about Sample to Terrence, then Herbie to all these other gigs. And I know, you know, you play with Mike Marino and all these other guys. So what do you do mentally to shift gears to be able to fit in those gigs? Because I feel like that is one of your greatest strengths as someone who admires you, is your ability to like play the music. And we know it's Kendrick Scott, but I feel like you kind of disappear into the music and you just serve it, you know? So
yeah.
How have you done that with these different bands?
Look, talking about my big brothers,
yeah.
I looked towards Blade.
Oof.
And I was like, okay, play with Bob Dylan. It took me so long to just listen to Trilogy and be like, okay, this is the baddest.
Yeah.
Just, you know, it was like, okay. And then, so I'm like, oh, he's playing with Bob Dylan. And I was just like, okay. I turned on the record, like, wait, what? And he played with Joni. And I was like,
hold up, you got to tell me about the Bob Dylan record. I'm not hip to that.
The, what's the name of this? I forgot the name of that record, man. But
okay.
He's on the Dylan.
I'll Google it. Wow, yes. I didn't know about that.
He's on the Dylan record. And then the Joni, and then, you know, just all the type of stuff, the Seal, all this type of stuff that he did. And he sounded like himself.
You're right.
Because at one point, even this is on another tip, I don't know how many drummers deal with this, but, you know, you're like, okay, I'm going to pull out this snare for this and this snare for that. And these cymbals for this person and this there. And then when I saw him do all of those type of gigs, and he's still playing with Redman and then also playing with Wayne and all that. And I would look, and it's like the same kit. And I'm just like, same type of kit, same type
Right.
And I was just like, okay, that just encouraged me to just try to make your sound fit. And then it also took me back to Haynes, because what did he do? He just Haynes across from Louis Armstrong till now. He's just Haynes and was himself with all of those people. So I don't know. Again, it's like simplicity breeds complexity, just kind of learning what the basis of whatever the music is, and then just dialing up how much of whatever you're trying to do. Just having that awareness of just being like, okay, texturally, for me, Gretchen was one of the biggest challenges, because I couldn't play like a drummer. I had to come at it like a percussionist. Mm. You know what I mean? I had to think of the drums as percussion. And then when we did some solos, I'd turn it up some and then turn it back down, because her voice, you know, for me, I've always thought about this. You want to have your, because Hal Crook told me about this in Berkeley. He's like, you want your sound to be powerful, but yet transparent. You know what I mean? Mm. It's like you want the drums to be in people's face, but the transparency comes from like knowing the Max Roach exercise, the dynamic exercise of, can you bring each of your limbs up and down? Like, can you play the hi-hat super loud? Like, the hi-hat super loud will work with somebody like Gretchen's voice because it's not taking up a sonic space. It's really hidden, and it's getting out of the way. But if I play the cymbal super loud, that's going to take up the sonic space. So I guess studying each of the drummers, like listening to Lex Humphries and being like, yo, the cymbal's way out front. And then listening to other cats that had the cymbal further back and kind of checking them out, creating the dream board of what do you think you want your sound to be. And then just relating all of those things that are authentic to you about what you love. Like, you love that Buddy Rich, but you got some other stuff with that, brother. You know what I mean? Your sound is like, as a composer, as an arranger, you're doing some other things with your sound in which lead you to occupy a certain space that not only sits at front, but it's also transparent. So you hear the rest of the group, no matter what group that is. So I guess, and after, seriously, after being with Terrence's band and learning about his compositional thinking, I started really thinking about everything that I'm playing as a drummer as a composition. And I think we forget about that. You know what I mean? It's like Earl Palmer was a composer.
Chick Webb, I didn't know that. Composer.
You know, they're all composers. Wow. I'm talking about.
Oh, absolutely.
Even with the pen and the sticks.
I didn't know that about Earl Palmer. Wow.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's a thing where if we realize the value of every note that we're playing, then we kind of look at it differently. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's kind of like when Max said the bass drum and the snare drum are European and the toms are native drums from Africa, and the cymbals are Asian. And you think about like, oh, okay. So when you sit down at the drum set, you realize you're playing America, right?
It's like, ooh, bro, is that an interview or something?
Yeah, it's one of his it's one of his workshops that he did, and I was just like, so when you sit down at the drum set, it's like you should be thinking about democracy. It's like you're sitting at democracy. You should be thinking about that on the bandstand. Then it was like, oh, wait. And then you think about that as an orchestra. This is an orchestra. And then that is an orchestra, too. It's like, oh, man. It starts to get really heavy.
See, that's a whole other conversation. See, I only got a few minutes left with you, so I got to go. I got to dig in and get more gems. So quick question from Pick and Stone, one of our audience members. He wants to know, did Lex play a lot with Donald Byrd? Like, what are some?
Yes, okay. Yes, I'm listening to Byrd in Flight right now.
Okay, that's, I'm gonna check that out. That's like too.
Byrd in Flight. I'm listening. I mean, I don't know, man. The cymbal beat, he has that high tuning on Byrd in Flight.
Okay.
And I just love that. I love him with Freddie as well.
Any specific Freddie record you wanna put out there?
What's the one with the one with Lex, it has everything.
Yeah, I know. I don't know the record name, but yeah. I've heard
it. I ain't gonna lie to you. I'm terrible with records.
Me too.
Much music and have no idea what the name of the records are. So I'm like, that's one thing I'm trying to get better with.
Cool.
So if there's some, my downfall, that is one.
Cool, man. So I'm sure we got some cats that are gonna dig in the basement for that. I have a few more questions, man. One, I have to ask you, being with Terrence, what was that experience like in the film score part of that band? You know, because I've listened to a bunch of the stuff, man, y'all have done, and I'm just curious, anything you want to share about that? Obviously, he taught you about the compositions and things like that, but that's a whole other bag. You know,
It's a whole other bag, but then I hate to keep saying it, but then it goes back to music as service, right? It goes back to like my roots. So then music in service of the picture, that means again, mama's giving you sad eye, the side eye, get out of the way of the dialogue,
right?
But it's out of the dialogue instead of out of the way of the solo or something.
But what about the literal side though, Kendrick, like in terms of setup, or did you have to change anything to adapt? To now you're dealing with bigger soundscapes and things?
That's the thing. I didn't. I didn't, and I don't know. Sometimes I look back on it and I'm just like, should I have pulled out the 22 kick and like?
So you
done
use 18 on a lot of that stuff?
18 or 20, and I'm muted. You know what I mean? And I'm muted. See, that was the thing that, and I'm still going through that now. I just got a brand new kit, and it has a 20 by 12 bass drum. And I
come
think
on, give us the specs, bro. Give us the all. Don't cheat us. Don't cheat us.
No. And I think I've arrived at my sound. I went from 18, then having an 18 and a 22, then 20. But the 20 was too deep, and I'm just like, no, that's not the sound. So now I've arrived. But I think. Just trying to have my sound fit. Like I was saying, I'm always going through this thing with my sound where I come from looking at my big brothers like Chris Dave, who would change his drum set every time you saw him. He would never have the same. I saw him play a gig one time where there was no snare in between his legs. And the snare was to the left.
Yeah.
So he's always challenging his brain to hear other things, to do other things. But I cannot do that, bro. I get so weirded out if my drums aren't tuned the same way and I don't have the same type of setup. If you look at pictures of my drums, they've only changed about that much the whole time I play. I can't do it. So,
bro, what's your new setup size-wise?
So it's 20 by 12, 12 by 8, 14 by 14, 14 by 6.5. And then a 16 on the left, like Papa Joe. But now I'm playing a snare with my left foot. It's 15 by 10. I've been trying to, it's funny because I was talking about Chris because, he called me and said, what's that? What's that? Kendrick, what is that? And I was like, oh, man. He's like, I like it. And we had this beautiful conversation where he told me, one of the reasons why he put up all the snares and did all this stuff was because he was challenging his creativity. And he said he heard something that he could not yet do. And that's pretty much where I am right now. I tell my students, I'm like, okay, so think of your greatest hero and then think about yourself and think about all the stuff that you can play in your mind, but you sit down and you can't do it. And then think your greatest hero has that too. And it's like, oh, wow. So Haynes has something in his mind.
Right.
Even though, Haynes is one of the greatest ever. I'm sure he has something in his mind where he's just like, ooh, I want to get to that too. And that's why we get up and practice every day.
Right.
And so that's something in my head right now that I'm hearing that I'm trying to work at and to build on. So that's just like my lifelong project that I'm
Man, I love that you talk about the 12-inch diameter because I just had to pre-record a few things and I was speaking to another drummer and they talked about the 12 as well. Like they actually talked about Elvin and how Elvin at one point I think played like a 16 by 12 bass drum and stuff. So it's really interesting to hear you talk about that. But man, I know we're running out of time. I just want to ask, sort of, because you referenced a lot about teaching. As we get ready to bring this episode to a close, I got to have you come back for part two, too, man. Because you got so much stuff. But one, I want to ask, what do you want this current generation to think about regarding the drums? Because I feel like clearly you're in a position where you're teaching the next generation. So, kind of like, what do you think about with that? And then obviously, what do you have coming up? I know we talked earlier about you just getting back from Europe and stuff. So, cause I feel like you're going to be one of those teachers, especially even for my own students. I have a few that I want to send to you that you kind of expand the mind. So of drummers. So what do you want this new generation of jazz drummers to think about?
Hubert Laws is a great flutist from Houston, and he came into a class that I was teaching, and he listened to the ensemble. He was like, "Oh yeah, okay, y'all are Dylan. Oh, Dylan, it sounds beautiful. The branches, baby, the branches." It's like what? The branches, the branches. And he kept saying it, and then he was like, "But the roots," and I was just like, "Oh man." So whatever branches you love, that branch of like we were talking about, of whoever, Papa Joe, who was Papa Joe's cat, right? So My thing would be if students were watching us right now and they're like, oh man, I love you and I love Kendrick, whatever, who you should be listening to who we were listening to and not us.
Yes.
So
yes.
Then you really understand. And like I said, to create the dream board of what you want to sound like, you have to be pretty much have to be really starkly honest with yourself about what you really like. Mm-hmm. I told Cass, I'm like, yo, if you like my playing and like everything about my playing, I probably wouldn't respect you because I suck at so much stuff that you got to understand, like, oh, okay, he's really good at this, but ooh, I don't know. Oh, but Ulysses on the other side, it's like, okay, so if I take this,
right,
the touch from this person,
right,
and the
right
sense of time from this person,
right,
and this leadership from this, you know what I mean?
Right,
so
right,
you got to develop the dream board by going to the roots and figuring out, okay, Lex, you know, going to Lex Humphries, be like, man, that cymbal beat, okay, but I don't know if I like that tuning. Oh, don't say that. You know what I mean? That's what you write in. That's what you write in your journals. Like, okay, this cymbal beat and this sound, that's something that I'm looking towards. So I always say, you know, go to the roots of the tree, be authentic to yourself, and then the authenticity will really, it will push the dust away from your lane. Your lane exists, but there's dust on it, and you don't see it until you start doing those things in which push away the dust for your lane. And just for me in general, I mean, I'm trying to work as a composer and trying to play better and everything. I have a premiere coming up at the Jazz Gallery on the 17th and 18th of September. I'm premiering some music and I entitled it Corridors because I feel like all of us have been inside of our homes. Hmm. And as you're in your home, you walk down the corridor, it's just like, oh man, the garage is now a gym, right? Your little brother's room is now the schoolhouse. And you know what I mean? It's like each room in our house has changed its function. And some rooms that we didn't go in pre-pandemic, we had to open the door and be like, wow. And then, so I started thinking, you know, what doors do we have in our country that stuff is sitting behind? You know, George Floyd opened up a door that we thought we had closed, and you know what I mean. And we thought that was closed. So I mean, it's a lot about that, and it's a lot about how we've you know, things have been taken away from us, and you know, that type of thing. So that I'm working with that.
Well, man, I just want to thank you, Kendrick. You seriously, man, you dropped such great gems, and even for me, man, I felt like you got me walking away from this. I'm gonna meditate on a lot of these thoughts, not only as an educator, but as a player, you know, and I love that you challenged me in some great ways. So to everybody out there, this was a true gem, man. I feel like you took us all to school, man. So thank you, brother. I appreciate
you. Well, I want to say thank you to you, man, for bringing people together in this way and having us talk and learn, because I've been checking out the series. And, you know, that's the great thing is we don't have the same type of fellowship that our heroes had. So in the way that you are creating this fellowship is so important. Wow. And so thank you for the work and for having me be a part of it to learn as well.
Well, thank you, brother. I appreciate you. And thanks for being here, man. As we bring this episode to a close, we're going to let y'all hear some of Brother Kendrick's music. And we are going to play something from A Wall Becomes a Bridge, which was released in 2019. One of his, or I should say his most recent record, and the track is going to be number 2. How do you say it, Kendrick? Is it Motion or Motion? Or
Motion.
Motion, okay.
Yeah,
it's
like moving forward and water.
Okay, cool. Like so, again, I want to thank y'all. Please tune in with us next week. We have a really, really great show coming up. I think we're going to have Joe Saylor next week, so really excited about that. But again, please put your internet snaps together for Kendrick Scott. He was amazing. And I appreciate y'all. And again, tune in with us every Wednesday at 5 with the show From the Drummer's Perspective at Open Studio Jazz. I also saw an ad there. Open Studio said there's some discounts on some courses today as well.
Man.
And they're a great resource. So again, thank you, Kendrick. And see everybody next Wednesday.
Yes, sir.